On Thursday, they shared the supper. In Mark's Gospel, again in chapter 14, we're told, in the evening, Jesus arrived with the 12. As they were at the table eating, Jesus said, "I tell you the truth, one of you eating with me here will betray me." They went to the olive grove called Gethsemane, and Jesus said, "Sit here while I go and pray." He took Peter, James, and John with him, and he became deeply troubled and distressed. He told them, "My soul is crushed with grief to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me." He went on a little farther and fell to the ground. There he prayed that, if it were possible, the awful hour awaiting him might pass him by. "Abba," he cried out, "Father, everything is possible for you. Please take this cup of suffering away from me. Yet I want your will to be done, not mine." Then he returned and found the disciples asleep. He said to Peter, "Simon, are you asleep? Couldn't you watch with me even 1 hour? Keep watch and pray, so that you will not give in to temptation. For the spirit is willing, but the body is weak." Then Jesus left them again and prayed the same prayer as before. When he returned to them again, he found them sleeping, for they couldn't keep their eyes open, and they didn't know what to say. When he returned to them the third time, he said, "Go ahead and sleep. Have your rest." "But no, the time has come. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinners. Up, let's be going. For look, my betrayer has come." And immediately, even as Jesus said this, Judas, one of the 12 disciples, arrived with a crowd of men armed with swords and clubs. They had been sent by the leading priests, the teachers of religious law, and the elders. The traitor, Judas, had given them a prearranged signal. "You will know which one to arrest when I greet him with a kiss. Then you can take him away under guard." As soon as they arrived, Judas walked up to Jesus. "Rabbi," he exclaimed, and gave him the kiss. It was on Thursday that he became valuable. He hadn't anything to sell, you understand, not since leaving his hammer and saw 3 years before. So he could probably knock you up a set of tables or hang you a couple of shells. But he wasn't into making things. Not now. Now his business was mending things. Lives and souls. And fixing things. Mainly our relationship with God. And of course he was into talking and teaching and listening and healing and forgiving and encouraging. All the things for which there's no wage and for which the job centre has no advertisements. So his work, in human terms, wasn't worth much. Nor indeed in human terms was he, for not being well dressed or well healed or well connected. He couldn't have attracted many ticket holders if they'd been selling tickets. But it was on Thursday that he became valuable, worth 30 pieces of silver. "Sit here while I pray," he said. "The sadness in my heart nearly crushes me. Stay here and keep watch with me. Father, I have shown your glory on earth. I have finished the work you gave me. I have given my disciples your message, and the world, it hated them. Yet I don't pray that they may be taken out of the world. I pray that they may be kept from evil." "Sleeping, Peter? Can you not stay awake even for an hour?" "Father, I pray not only for my friends, but for all who believe their words. I pray that they may be one, just as you and I are one. Father, the world does not know you, but I know you and they know you, so that the world may believe that you sent me, may they be one." "Peter, keep watch and pray. Do not be drawn by temptation. The spirit is willing, but oh, the flesh is weak. Father, if it is possible, take away this cup of suffering from me. But not what I want, but what you want. What you want, Father. I know that's what matters. Lord, be with us in this day. Keep us awake to your presence and awake to your love. In Christ our Lord. Amen.